This is an example of heterogeneous equilibrium, namely we have different phases reacting. In this case, a liquid reacting with a solid to form two other solids. And the critical thing about this is that in this calculation, we're assuming none of the phases mix. In other words, these are separate individual crystals. And so we have a calcium oxide crystal. It's different from a thorium crystal. And the question is, then what's the maximum temperature at which calcium liquid is going to reduce thorium oxide? And we're given delta G's for the reaction at two temperatures. So what we're going to do is to calculate the temperature, we're going to first use the equilibrium expression. And the equilibrium expression, general form of equilibrium, we're saying the activity of thorium. In general, we would put this symbol to indicate that it's in a mixture. But since thorium is in its own phase, we don't need the symbol here. And it's likewise true, activity of calcium oxide. And the activity of calcium liquid squared. And the activity of thorium oxide. Now, activity is defined as fugacity of thorium at the conditions of temperature and pressure, divided by fugacity of pure thorium at standard conditions, say 1 bar pressure, and likewise for the other component. So this is the equilibrium expression. Now, the fugacity at whatever pressure, and it's not specified here, divided by the fugacity at same pure material, same crystal, standard conditions, is essentially the same. In other words, pressure affects the fugacities of solids and liquids very little. So basically, this equilibrium constant becomes 1. Each of these terms is 1. And so our equilibrium constant is 1 at the conditions where we would have these phases in equilibrium. On either side of this temperature where the equilibrium constant is 1, we're either going to have reaction going in one direction to all of one of the components reacts, or reaction going in the other direction to all of one of the components reacts. Now we have K. We know that the equilibrium constant is equal to the exponential of the change in Gibbs free energy over RT. So what we're going to do then is calculate the conditions where K equals 1 corresponds to the Gibbs free energy change being 0, because an exponential of 0 is equal to 1. Now, the question becomes, at what temperature does delta G equal 0? So let's use the information we're given and use the, if you like, the definition of delta G in terms of delta H and a given temperature, delta S. So we can substitute in for our two temperatures, our two values of Gibbs free energy. Let's do that. So I made the substitution and written this in calories instead of kilocalories. I'm also assuming that delta H did not change with temperature. That's usually a pretty good assumption, assuming that delta S also is not changed significantly with temperature. And so therefore, I can take these two equations and solve for delta H and delta S to get a general expression for delta G as a function of temperature. And if I just subtract the two equations, I can eliminate delta H. And so let's do that. And so I have a value for delta S. I took the first equation, subtracted it from the second equation. Delta H disappeared. I can now substitute into either one of these equations this delta S value. And if I do that, I can calculate delta H. So, a couple things. Exothermic reaction. That means as I raise the temperature, the equilibrium constant becomes smaller. And that's why the problem statement says estimate the maximum temperature. Because as I go above that temperature where delta G at standard conditions equals 0. As I go above that temperature, equilibrium is going to shift back to the left. That's the maximum temperature because it's exothermic. And so now we just need to take, starting again, delta G as delta H minus T delta S. We know delta G is zero. We calculate the values for delta H and delta S, so we can solve for T. So temperature 1760 Kelvin. We're below that temperature, and reaction is going to the right. We're reducing the thorium oxide. Above that temperature, reaction is going to the left, and reaction will continue until we use up all of the one of the products, the either calcium oxide or thorium, above that temperature. In terms of significant figures, this is probably 1800 K based on the information that we were given.